I want to talk about Chinatown. It's one of my favorite films ever. I ranked it at 7th on my last top 10 films, and recently I corrected that list, and it got set back to 8th. Point is, I love it. But why is it important to talk about? Why is it so damn good, and why is it, at least for me, the most complex case of art versus artist? Chinatown, directed by Roman Polanski and carried by Robert Towne's script and a young, relatively handsome Jack Nicholson, who gets a terrible face wound. The plot, which I'll get into in a minute, is based on the real-life LA water wars in the 1930s, which Jake gets all wrapped up in. Chinatown, set in 1937, follows Jake Giddies, a private investigator and joke prolonger.
He comes back in the room, he starts screwing again, he gets up to start to leave again to go look at the moon. She looks at him and says, "Hey, what's the matter with you? You're screwing just like a Chinaman." Jesus. That Barney.
Was tasked by a woman named Evelyn Mulray to track her husband, Hollis, an LA Water Department bureaucrat, because she suspects he's cheating.
Now, what seems to be the problem?
My husband, I believe, is seeing another woman.
No, really?
Jake sees him hanging out with some young woman and takes pictures, which, when they get out, cause him to be contacted by Evelyn Mulray, the real Evelyn.
You see, I'm Mrs. Evelyn Mulray.
The first one was just an imposter, who for some reason wants the Mulrays discredited. Jake then, further investigating Hollis, finds he is dead, drowning. And his death is being investigated by a former work rival of Jake's. Jake used to be a cop. It's more important later. Now, here comes the water wars bit. The real history is not important to the movie, but it's a very interesting backdrop, at least. So there's a drought, but Jake finds that large quantities of water are released from the reservoir every single night. Jake is told off by the security chief of the water department, Claude Mulvihill, and gets his nose cut really bad.
You know
by
what
some
happens
henchmen.
To nosy fellows? Huh? No? Wanna guess? Huh? No? Okay. They lose their noses.
One of whom is played by the director of the film. Jake also receives a call from a woman named Ida Sessions.
I was the one who pretended to be Mrs. Mulray. Remember?
Shut the fuck up.
She doesn't say much, but tells Jake to check the obituaries. Jake now works in a strained, untrusting partnership with Evelyn, who believes, along with Jake, that Hollis was murdered.
In case you're interested, your husband was murdered. Somebody has been dumping thousands of tons of water from the city's reservoirs, and we're supposed to be in the middle of a drought. He found out about it, and he was killed. I goddamn near lost my nose, and I like it. I like breathing through it. And I still think that you're hiding something.
Jake soon figures out that Evelyn is the daughter of Noah Cross. Noah Cross is a wealthy and mysterious man with business ties to the water department, who Jake meets with. The scene is incredibly intense. Jake and Cross are amiable, it sounds like, but there's a lot of tension in the scene. Cross acts like Jake knows more than he should, and he dismisses his daughter as well, and offers to double her fee if Jake works for him. Jake does not accept, but doesn't exactly refuse, as it becomes increasingly obvious to Jake that Evelyn is not telling him lies, but certainly not the whole truth. Jake goes to the Hall of Records for some information, cough cough, and then to some orange orchards. Groves? I'm not sure. He's violently accosted when he investigates the orange farming establishment because they think he works for the water department, which they say has been tampering with the water of late. Jake wakes up from this KO to Evelyn, who, despite her information withholding, seems to genuinely care about Jake. And when he examines the obituaries and the scraps of paper he has, what unfurls before him and Evelyn is a strikingly large plot. A plot from somewhere, including the water department, to dry up land and buy it in bulk, probably for money, and also to develop and incorporate more land into Los Angeles.
They're blowing these farmers out of their land and then picking it up for peanuts. You have any idea what this land would be worth with a steady water supply? About $30 million more than they paid for it.
Hollis knew about this.
That's why he was killed.
Jake and Evelyn go to a retirement home to see if the names of the people buying the land are actually aware, or if their names are laundry. They do confirm that the buyers are not aware, but are attacked by Claude Mulvihill and his thugs. The two go to Evelyn's house, where... Oh, Jesus Christ, I cannot put that on... And in a more solemn moment, Jake explains his previous job.
I was trying to keep someone from being hurt. I ended up making sure that she was hurt.
Evelyn gets a frantic call and then leaves suddenly, prompting the 10 perception stat Jake to follow her. He's very upset because she's seeing the woman who he believes to be Hollis's mistress. She gets upset and seems to hold back information.
She's my sister.
The next day, Jake is drawn to Ida Sessions' apartment by a mysterious call. He finds her dead, and he's jump-scared comically by his coworker guy, the one from before, Lou Escobar. Escobar says that there was salt water in Hollis Mulray's lungs, which makes a disturbing amount of sense coupled with Escobar's belief that Evelyn is guilty of his murder, because there is a saltwater pond at the Mulray mansion. He then practically orders Jake to go find Evelyn and bring her back, or he'll be charged as well. Jake finds broken eyeglasses in the saltwater pool and finds her servants packing her things up. And on a whim, but a good one, Jake goes to Catherine's house, Evelyn's sister, where he furiously confronts Evelyn.
She's my sister and my daughter!
She breaks down and reveals she's both. Cross raped Evelyn when she was 15, and Catherine is the child of that pregnancy. It's sickening, but at this point, Jake thinks he has it. He's got the papers, the proof. He has the glasses. He has a plan for Evelyn and Catherine to flee to Mexico by way of Chinatown. So he has this showdown. Cross reveals the glasses are his, and Jake is now certain. He's also certain that all the water department fuckery, all the water warring, is squarely to blame on Cross. Jake has figured out what reason there may be in this case. He's also found the answer, but he's outnumbered. And they force him to drive where Evelyn and Catherine are. In Chinatown. Escobar is there as well, who detains Jake.
Get away from her.
You'll have to kill me first.
Get away! Get away! Captain, close the door. Halt!
Evelyn has been shot dead. Cross perversely clutches the screaming Catherine as Jake watches in disbelief. Escobar urges his partners to take him home.
Big favor? Take him home. Take him home! Just get him the hell out of here!
It's the fact that he's so right which makes it impossible for him to see. He has failed to prevent something horrible, something that in all truth is very difficult to understand, especially by rationality.
Forget it, Jake. It's Chinatown.
Jake follows a clear path of reason. He tries to understand what's going on, what the point is, and what is he left with? Nothing. It's something you can piece together. It makes sense in a way, but it was never something he could have solved. What this film does best is not all its Oedipal themes, as in Prevention of a Prophecy, all its mystery, its noir aesthetics. It was never a mystery. Chinatown lays out evidence for the audience to see. It has objects, red herrings, conspiracy, culprits. It shows the character struggling on the way to a solution. But in the end, we uncover something far more uncomfortable and messy than anyone would have thought. Something that can never be solved. And something Jake should best forget. Let's talk about something else very uncomfortable and messy. The director of this film. Thank you. Roland Barthes' 1967 essay, The Death of the Author, is a very important text to the concept of analysis and authorial intent. Barthes argues that including authorial intent or the author's personal perspective into criticism or analysis of a work is inherently limiting to the work. It is unproductive, he says. Yes, I haven't read this essay and I'm simplifying here, but I read this by my dad, who's a fan of France generally, and he said it was correct overall. I disagree, mostly for one reason. This is almost always selectively implied. The essay, henceforth, for this video, is pretty much useless, but the basic claim behind it is central to modern internet talk about problematic media and problematic people. I think, most of the time, people apply this concept, the separation of art and the artist, when they cannot deal with it. And I don't mean that in a disrespectful way, I mean that in a very specific way. You're doing it because of cognitive dissonance, because you dislike the person who made the work you like. Some intellectual types might actually apply this concept in truth, but to most people engaging in any sort of media discourse, it is used like this, to separate an unlikable person from their likable work. Now there are examples and cases of artists who are widely admired, people who have nothing distasteful in their lives to give anyone reason to want to disconnect them from their work. Tolkien springs to mind for me. But today I want to talk about my least favorite example of art versus artist, a film that I've been spending too much time addressing already, Chinatown. As I hinted at a minute ago, and you may already know, Roman Polanski, the director of Chinatown, is a very distasteful man, who had an interesting life I'm going to talk about briefly. Polanski was born in 1933 in interwar France to Jewish parents. His father was from Poland. His family moved back to Poland when he was a child, and lived through the horror that was occupied Poland. His mother died in the Holocaust, but his father survived, whom he lived with in post-war Poland. He was fascinated with film from an early age, and studied in Łódź. But after a few years in communist Poland as a young man, there was only so high he could go. So he led a strange decade in the 1960s, directing many films from France to Britain to the United States, where he met and married Sharon Tate, a promising young American actress and model. The next year, 1969, while Polanski was in London, the Manson family killed his pregnant wife, Sharon Tate. His absence from the family on this night left Polanski feeling pessimistic and incredibly dissatisfied with life. I think it's hard to understand Chinatown without understanding this. It leaves Jake feeling like he had no purpose, like his attempts to save Evelyn were meaningless. The corruption continues, Cross ends up with Catherine, set up to continue his violence and trauma. The script bears no explicit bit of Polanski's touch, yet the emotions, the tone, it reeks of Polanski. There's no easy way to talk about this next part. If you don't want to hear about, rape, don't watch this part. I don't intend to fully describe any events from this case, but I would suggest skipping or leaving if you're sensitive to that sort of thing. The case is often described as a sexual abuse case. That's not true, or at least deceptive. In truth, Roman Polanski was charged with, in People of the State of California versus Roman Polanski, rape by use of drugs, perversion, sodomy, lewd and lascivious act upon a child under 14, unlawful sexual intercourse with a female under the age of 18, and furnishing a controlled substance to a minor. In March 1977, Roman Polanski was photographing a 13-year-old girl, Samantha Geimer, for French Vogue. He, as Geimer stated, got a little scary. He gave her alcohol, and a quaalude and proceeded to rape her. She later stated that she said no at least four times. A plea bargain was arranged for Polanski, and he subjected himself to the required psychiatric evaluation. Under the arrangement, he went to Europe to complete a film, but when he was photographed with young girls at Oktoberfest, he was ordered to return to California. He was released from the psych evaluation, and as all parties saw it, even the victim, he wouldn't have gotten any time in prison, and shouldn't have. But the judge apparently suggested prison and deportation. He later stated that he did not propose to follow the recommendations without any additional time in custody. It's a bit unclear exactly what he said and to who. It may have been an offhand remark or a genuine decision for him to give 50 years in prison, but whatever it was, it scared the hell out of Polanski, who fled to London and then France where he was a citizen, where he still is a citizen. He's never returned to the United States and seldom leaves France. I hope it's not a bold position that Roman Polanski is a very bad man, not only for raping a child, but for running away from the consequences of such an act. In 1977, he said some disturbing things about the case. If I'd killed somebody, it wouldn't have been so much appeal to the press, you see. But fucking, you see. And the young girls. Judges want to fuck young girls. Juries want to fuck young girls. Everyone wants to fuck young girls. No, they don't, Roman. It's just you. And in 1983, he said, I like the girls of that age. And later in the interview, looking back at it, it was probably bound to happen. French essayist and public intellectual Alain Finkielkraut said, after a slew of re-emerging legal issues for Polanski, Polanski is not a pedophile. His victim, the complainant, who withdrew her complaint, who never wanted a public trial, who obtained reparation, was not a little girl. A little girl, a child at the time of the events. It was a teenage girl who posed naked for Vogue Homme, and Vogue Homme is not a pedophile magazine. I hope... Oh, fuck. This makes me feel ill to think about. I hope I don't have to make the rather obvious connection between this French intellectual and something that French intellectuals are oftentimes associated with. It seems to me that it's not the public or judges who want to commit rape, just Roman Polanski. Now you may ask, and validly, why does this matter? He didn't do this on the set of Chinatown. In fact, it was 3 years after the film was completed. Well, because Roman Polanski did this Vogue photoshoot in Jack Nicholson's house while he was on a ski trip. And Nicholson's girlfriend, Angelica Houston, who is present in the house and suspicious of Polanski's closed-door behavior, is the daughter of John Houston, the man who plays Noah Cross. See, I'm not just uncomfortable with the same man who directed one of my favorite films being a sex criminal. I'm uncomfortable because his actions had a direct connection to Chinatown. I don't care that every party except the judge wanted no prison time. I don't care that Polanski is 90. 90 years is too long for a man like him. He's a fugitive in the United States, a convicted sex criminal, and I think he should have gotten worse. Roman Polanski is a bad man. He raped a child and fled. I don't feel comfortable while watching a movie he made, and especially not one so connected to his crime. It seems like Polanski and his victim have made amends in some ways, and are at least on emailing terms. And also, Geimer has gone on to state that the way that the trial affected, like the publicity of the trial, was horrifying, and in fact worse than the actual event. Now, I don't think this matters to my point. Editing it now, this section is not very objective. I hope my last section felt emotional, because it is emotional. I don't feel better watching Chinatown, knowing that Polanski and his victim are on better terms now, that she wishes he could just return and have it all be over with. That doesn't make me feel any better. I don't like talking about pedophiles, and I don't like watching their movies. Every time I watch this movie, I love it. It's better every time. But I can't get that little voice out of the back of my head. I could delude myself into thinking all I really love is Robert Towne's script or Jack Nicholson. Don't misunderstand me, those things are amazing. But part of me knows it's the direction too, and that's not easy to admit. It makes me feel the kind of confused where I really know the answer. It's really hard to resolve that conflict, to accept that bad people can make good things, and sometimes they're too similar to be separated. I could very well try to forget about it, to separate the art from the artist. But this isn't the sort of thing that I can forget. It's the sort of thing that cannot be resolved with a real answer, with rationality. I'll never be able to resolve my cognitive dissonance about Chinatown and Polanski. The obvious response to cognitive dissonance is to forget. You can't spend every moment of your life worrying about something that cannot be resolved.
Forget it, Jake. It's Chinatown.
But I think sometimes it's worth talking about.